Father, I want us to be swallowed up in this psalm. Not that it's a happy place to be, but to learn how to be in an unhappy place is what we need. And this psalmist does it so well. He is miserable so well. I want you to teach your people how to be struck down well, how to be in turmoil well, how to be downcast well, how to have waves break over them well. And the Psalms, and this one in particular, is so well suited to help us. So grant that we would know how to feel and how to think with you in the Psalms. Christ, I pray. Amen. your people how to be struck down well, how to be in turmoil well, how to be downcast well, how to have waves break over them well.
I'm Joe Koo, and I'm one of the regulars at the Lidcombe service. Today might be week 20, week 10, or even your first week joining us here to gather and do church service over our live stream. Whichever the length of time, I want to warmly welcome you to join us our service today. Our church halls might be a little bit emptier, but we are still one church being built up together with Christ as our cornerstone. So as we gather together across our city, may I encourage you to put aside any distractions and cast your burdens and anxieties on our Lord, to worship and praise him wholeheartedly, and to hear and respond to the word of God today. A reminder that for all people, that you can find our bulletin at gracepoint.org.au/bulletin. To begin our service this evening, I'm going to open us up in a word of prayer with an excerpt from Psalm 61 to help us open up our hearts to God, and particularly around those who might be feeling a bit faint-hearted and weary. So if you will please bow your heads with me in prayer. Psalm 61. Hear my cry, O God. Listen to my prayer. From the ends of the earth I call to you. I call as my heart grows faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you have been my refuge, a strong tower against the foe. I long to dwell in your tent forever and take refuge in the shelter of your wings. For you, God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, Lord, you are our righteous King, our loving Savior, and our eternal joy. You are the one that fills our hearts and makes us new again. But Lord, it is easy for us to feel distracted, anxious, or disappointed with life, and particularly during these days where there seems to be no end in sight. Lord, in our weariness, draw us closer to you and to Christ. Help us anchor in the unshakable and the eternal joy that we have in you. Help us to see your goodness and take refuge and comfort in your great love for us that endures forever. Help quiet our souls and listen to your word today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, one way that we can draw closer to God and be led to be closer to our rock and refuge is to worship and praise our God in song. It's a great way to reflect upon the truths in the lyrics whilst also singing praise to him. So I'm going to hand it over to our music team. So would you all please stand as we give praise to our great God.
My Jesus, my Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge.
us continue to sing.
We have come to a time of congregational prayer. It is a time where we can approach the God of the universe in reverent fear and awe, but also with closeness and great love. Prayer is a time where we can personally draw near to God and come with all of our fears, our anxieties, our needs, and with thankful hearts. Psalm 145 tells us that the Lord is righteous and faithful, and that the Lord is near to all who call on him in truth. It's these truths that we meditate on and approach God with, knowing that he is faithful, that he listens to our prayer requests, and he responds. We can approach God with full faith and certainty, with Jesus Christ as a high priest, and lay all our requests at his throne. So I'm going to invite up Edwina, who will be praying for us today.
Hello, my name's Edwina, and I'll be leading us today together in congregational prayer. So please join me as we come to God in prayer as a church community. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. Our souls yearn, even faint, for the courts of the Lord. Our heart and our flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young, a place near your altar. Lord Almighty, our King and our God, blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. How blessed we are, Lord Almighty, that you have cleansed us of our sins and allowed us into your mighty presence forever. How unbelievably comforting it is to know that not one second, hour, or moment passes in the week where we are completely alone and unable to approach you, the living and holy God. What a joy it is for us to praise you together, Lord, because only you and not one single other thing in this world is worthy of all our praise. Father, we give you great thanks for the improvements in the number of new infections of COVID-19 around Australia this week. Help us rest in the truths that no disease in this world will ever be stronger than you, Lord, and that you are good as we continue to seek your mercy. May you heal those suffering sicknesses and loneliness right now, gracious and kind Father, for you are able to bring restoration and fulfillment. We give you thanks for the sacrificial work of healthcare workers around the world. May you provide for them and strengthen them with your spirit as you continue to grant wisdom and protection. May you also bless the work of their hands. Father, how we yearn to see non-believers view your kingdom as precious pearls as they come to know the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus our Lord. Gracious Father, move and stir our selfish hearts to love them enough to want to evangelize to them and to want to share the magnificent good news of salvation with them. Help us to fight against living lives that point to sources other than Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life. May our hearts not grow complacent and short-sighted. Teach us to soberly number our days, Father, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. By your grace, may we see the urgency and joy in sharing your gospel so that more and more and more may share the freedom in being made right with you. Fix our eyes on you, Lord, and don't let them move, for we know that the mind of the flesh is death, but the mind of the Spirit is life and peace, and we long for the peace that comes only from you, Lord. In Jesus' almighty, powerful name we pray. Amen.
We've now come to the time where we can reflect on biblical truths in the form of a catechism. Catechism means to teach and is done in the form of a question and answer. It's a summary of our beliefs and are taken directly from the Bible. So it's biblical and theological truth. The catechism that we will be reading today is taken from the Heidelberg Catechism and we'll be reading question 35. You can follow along in the bulletin or on the screen. The catechism reads, what do you confess when you say he was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary? And the answer is the eternal Son of God, who is and remains true and eternal God, took upon himself true human nature from the flesh and blood of the Virgin Mary through the working of the Holy Spirit. Thus, he is also the true seed of David and like his brothers in every respect, yet without sin. So why is it so important that we stress this piece of doctrine? And why does it matter as to how he was born? The reason is because it tells us about the nature of Jesus Christ and of who he is. We cannot separate Jesus' identity from his conception because this informs us how we come to understand his divine nature, but also how he can empathize with us in all of our temptations. We see that Jesus, by being conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, was shown to be of divine nature, that he was God incarnate and was not born from the seed of a man, but of God himself. This in itself shows that Jesus was first and foremost God himself, who gave up his rights and his privileges to sit in heaven, but came down to live amongst us. However, by also being born of the Virgin Mary, God is able to uphold his promises to Abraham and to David by saying that there will be one from the line of David who will be seated on the throne and rule. By being born as a servant in the form of man, Jesus came down to live the life that we are called to live and take the punishment of sin for us. He himself was without sin and the perfect sacrifice for us. Jesus' identity was both man and God. And because of this, we can now live in full confidence and faith of the mercy and forgiveness provided to us in him. So I shall read out the question and we can respond in one voice. The question: what do you confess when you say he was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary? The answer: the eternal Son of God, who is and remains true and eternal God, took upon himself true human nature from the flesh and blood of the Virgin Mary through the working of the Holy Spirit. Thus, he is also the true seed of David and like his brothers in every respect, yet without sin. So on this note, we now have the opportunity to hear the word of God being read out to us. The passage tonight is going to be from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1 to 8. And I'm going to invite up Tom, who's going to read the Bible for us tonight.
Hi, my name is Tom and I'm from the Lidcombe campus. As you heard, today's Bible passage comes from 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 1 to 8. Hear God's word. As for other matters, brothers and sisters, we instructed you how to live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. Now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. It is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable, not in passionate lusts like the pagans who do not know God, and that in this matter no one should wrong or take advantage of a brother or sister. The Lord will punish all those who commit such sins, as we told you and warned you before, for God did not call us to be impure, but to live a holy life. Therefore, anyone who rejects this instruction does not reject a human being, but God, the very God who gives you his Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Tom. Hello, everybody. My name is Kamal. I'm one of the pastors of this church, and it's my privilege to be bringing us God's word from this very important section of the Bible. Okay, ba-doom, psh, drummer, I wish we could have a little cue there. Let's pray, because this is God's word, and I expect us to have an absolutely wonderful time enjoying what God has to say about sexuality this morning. So let's ask God's Holy Spirit to sanctify, to make holy his word to us today. Let's pray. Thank you, Father God, that you give to us instruction about how to live in every part of our life, including intimate parts like marriage and sexuality, and how to conduct ourselves in this very meaningful and important part of our life. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that because of his death and resurrection for us, we can be confident that you are good, and your ways are right and wholesome, and that we can look forward to life beyond life in Jesus Christ. Thank you for your scriptures, your word written. Please, we invoke you, we ask you, Holy Spirit, to make us holy and help us to understand what it means for us to conduct this very intimate and important part of our life, most of all for you, and in that, to enjoy the good way of life that you have for every one of us. Amen. Everybody knows that sex is special. Our bodies tell us, our feelings tell us. Sex makes us feel good. Sex makes us feel alive. Sex is connected with love and romance. When we fall in love with someone, we want to have sex with them. And when we have sex with them, we bind emotionally with them closer and closer. And sex literally makes new life. The reality is we're all here because of an act of sex. And so everybody knows that sex is special. Our bodies, our feelings tell us so. The question, though, is why? What makes sex special? What is sex special for? Why do our bodies and emotions tell us what they tell us? Well, the traditional answer is that sex is special because it creates families. I've already mentioned it. Sex between a man and a woman makes babies, and that's why that man and that woman should stay together and bring up their biological children. That's why the traditional family-oriented perspective limits sex to heterosexual marriage. It's not actually unique to Christianity. It's the traditional family perspective on sexuality. But you know what? That sounds really boring. Because that makes sex sound like slavery. It means that sex is all about limiting my options and locking me up with one person for life and throwing away the key. I mean, that's no fun. That's not what we believe in this liberated and free and open society of the. It's the 21st century. It's 2020 for crying out loud. Contemporary Western society says that sex is about fun and fulfillment. So sex is special because it makes us feel satisfied. I mean, who cares about children anyway? Contraception is really cheap and easy. And so we need to be free to explore and experiment with our sexuality. That's our taken-for-granted attitude today in order to find sexual fulfillment. Victoria's COVID regulations even have an exemption, a sex exemption. Victoria, you can make social visits. Usually you can't visit people, right? But you can leave your house to visit a person if you have an intimate personal relationship with them. How do they check? Okay, never mind. Let's not go there. All right. So, everyone knows that sex is special. Traditional society says that sex is special because of families. Contemporary Western society says sex is special because you need to be free and fulfilled. What does the Bible say? What does what we as Christians consider to be God's communication. What does that say about why sex is special? Well, the Bible says sex is fun, but not just for fun and fulfillment. And it might surprise you to hear this, the Bible doesn't simply say sex is for families. The Bible says sex has an even greater purpose. Sex is fundamentally about honoring God, pleasing God. And so the Bible's basic attitude is that if we sanctify or make our sex holy according to God's pattern, then we will have a worthwhile and fruitful and fulfilling life. Then we will have healthy families. Does that make sense? That's why verse 1 of our passage, if you've closed your Bibles or closed down your Bible applications, please open them up again. You can find an outline of this sermon on GracePoint.go/sermon, and you can also find it on our Bible app bulletin, which is GracePoint.go/bulletin. Verse 1 of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 says, "As for other matters, brothers and sisters, we instructed you how to live, in order to please yourselves and enjoy life." That's not what it says, is it? "We instructed you how to live in order to please your parents and be good little traditional legalistic moralistic boys and girls." That's not what it says either. Live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. So well done, Thessalonians. "We urge you," says the Apostle Paul and his team of evangelists with him, "we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus," not on his own authority, in the authority of Jesus Christ, God incarnate, "to do this more and more." The Bible thinks sex is holy, special first of all to God, and that's why the talk, the title for today's Bible talk is Holy Sex. And did you notice how this idea of holiness, our sexuality, God himself thinking that it's precious and wonderful, that's present in the whole passage. In verse 3, it says, it is God's will that you should be sanctified, and the word sanctified is just another form, another grammatical form of holiness. But what does it mean to be sanctified? Ew, it means to avoid sex because sex is dirty and ugly. No, it means to avoid sexual immorality. In other words, there is a positive way. God wants you to enjoy good sex, but he wants to enjoy holy sex, not just sex any old way. And verse 7 is the same. God did not call us to be impure, so therefore you have to avoid sex. No, he wants us to live a holy life. And in the context of the passage, what the apostle means in the name and authority of Jesus Christ is that we control and manage and guide our sexuality according to God's patterns, not just what we want, nor necessarily just what our traditional family values and society says. That's what verse 4 of our passage says. Each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy. There you go. Holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the pagans who do not know God. Now, I don't blame you if this talk about controlling our desires sounds a bit frightening, dangerous, and oppressive. But if you think about it, we control lots of areas of our life because we know that if we let that aspect of our life go out of control, it becomes downright dangerous. So I was driving down the street to come to the church hall to record, to broadcast this service. The traffic coming the other direction was really light. So just because I wanted to get here on time, I thought I'd cross the median strip and go against the normal flow of traffic. I didn't, in case you're wondering. Don't call the police. That's not what we do. We control our driving because we know that if we let our car go out of control, we could kill someone. We manage, we control our businesses. Some of us get paid big money to be a chief executive officer, to be a manager, a financial controller. We give our money, our hard-earned money, to people to control and invest it on our behalf. And we pay them big money to make our money work. We control even our bodies. We diet. We exercise, especially now that it's getting a bit warm and we need to lose all that COVID fat, so that we have a beach body again and all that sort of thing. So we control our consumption, but sex, nah, just do whatever you want. I'm sorry, that's exactly what God, in order to have a good and wholesome life, tells us not to do. In verse 4, the opposite to holy and honorable is passionate lust. Letting our sexuality go out of control. We'll damage ourselves and hurt other people as well. That is the invitation and warning from Almighty God. And isn't it nice that God, who knows how sex operates, actually tells us how to have a good and healthy life in this very important and intimate part of our life? God knows how sex works because he made it. When we buy stuff online in order to keep ourselves entertained, or because we need electronic equipment to get by in this online time of lockdown, we get something from Kogan, we have to follow the instructions to set it up correctly. And if we don't, we break it and we void the warranty because we didn't follow the instructions. Well, that's the same thing God does. He created us as sexual beings. And therefore, because he thinks sex is special, because he thinks sex is holy, he tells us how to enjoy the best possible sexual life. And that means following his pattern. So first of all, it means controlling our sexuality according to his pattern. And that pattern is so special, it actually goes right back to the beginning of the Bible. So the Apostle Paul does not, in this passage, 1 Thessalonians 4, give us detailed instructions, but we can see that underlying what the apostle says is what God himself and Jesus says. So if we go right back to Genesis chapter 1, if you've got your Bible app or your Bible's open, just flip right back to the beginning. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, it says that when God created humanity, he created us male and female. And then in verse 28, Genesis 1:28, it says that God commanded humanity to be fruitful and multiply. And that doesn't mean just grow vegetables and do maths. I mean, that's a fine ISO activity, but it means have sex and make babies. And in Genesis chapter 2, we have the famous account of Adam and Eve, the first wedding. God makes Eve out of Adam's side, out of his rib. And then Adam rejoices over his bride, because she is just like him, another human being, bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh, but she's different. Different in a way that is wonderful and appealing and beautiful and fits perfectly with him. And Jesus, God incarnate, unsurprisingly, he brings these two passages together. If you flip over to Matthew chapter 19, Matthew 19 verses 4 to 6, which also, by the way, is in Mark 10, Matthew 19 verses 4 to 6, Jesus himself says, haven't you read that at the beginning the Creator made them male and female and said, for this reason a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. So Jesus, if you were carefully listening or reading that passage, you'll see that Jesus himself puts together Genesis chapter 1 with Genesis chapter 2. Sex is special because it brings two people of opposite sexes together. Literally, physically. And it builds relationship, it builds love between two different people of the two different sexes. That is why God loves families. So I stand by what I said, that God thinks sex is holy beyond just families, but sex is holy because it's important to God for families, or families are important to God. Now, some of you may have been hurt by the oppressive imposition of traditional sexual values, perhaps by a church, perhaps by your parents, perhaps by a family background which is just valuing sexual purity, which is good, but you may feel that like they're just telling you to be a good, legal, morally upright legalist. And let me tell you, in the name of God, don't let that spoil the goodness of God's pattern. Sex is much bigger than just traditional families, and traditional families are not God. If you believe that sex is for families, good, keep it up, but do so. Keep that belief because God says so, not just because your family says so. And if you are a parent and you've been just slamming your children because you say so, because mommy says so, because daddy says so, please stop. That's the fastest way to spoil sexuality, because we are not God. God is God, and he has given us his healthy pattern, his holy pattern. In the Bible, show people, according to the Bible, that sex is good because sex is holy. In fact, sex is so good that the Thessalonians, it actually put the Thessalonians in danger of accidentally using it wrongly. Did you notice verse 6? Verse 6 says, in this matter, no one should wrong or take advantage of a brother or sister. Now, Paul there doesn't mean literal biological brothers and sisters. He means a fellow Christian. Paul loved the Thessalonians, and last week, for those of us who are regulars at church, remember Pastor Elliot showed us last week how Paul loved the Thessalonians so much, he sent Timothy on a mission, a personal messenger, to go and see how the Thessalonians were going. And when Timothy returned, Paul rejoiced, saying, Timothy has brought good news of how well you're going. Yeah, the Thessalonians are still Christians. Yeah, the Thessalonians love Jesus and love each other. Woo, my life is worth living. Now, dear friends, if we belong to Jesus, then we are brothers and sisters in Christ. We are children of God. We call God Father. The Holy Spirit brings us together. And as family members of God, God invites and commands us to care for each other. That means we're going to get to know each other in intimate ways. I mean, that's what family does, isn't it? We know what makes each other happy so we can cheer each other up when life is hard. We know what makes each other sad so we can get on each other's nerves. Please don't do that. You know what siblings are like, sibling rivalry. We celebrate the victories. We clean up the mess after each other's failures. That's what family does. And that is what the Thessalonian Christians were doing. And that, GracePoint Church, and anyone who's watching, this is what a real church should do. A real church should know each other, should love each other really, really intimately. But that's the problem. Or that's the danger. Because here, I think the apostle is saying that you Thessalonians, you love each other so much, that's really fantastic. Be careful that you don't sexualize those relationships. Non-sexual, godly, holy sexuality actually leads to sexual healing. And that is what the apostle, that is what God is holding out to us today. Holy sexuality heals the damage done by perhaps oppressive traditional imposition of legalistic sexuality, yeah, but also the damage done by the libertine free, the exhaustion and disappointment of desperately seeking sexual satisfaction. A whole generation of young people has grown up expecting to find fulfillment and happiness in sexual experimentation. It doesn't work. It hasn't worked. It's never been. Sex has never been about that. Constant sexual experimentation leaves us exhausted and empty and miserable. Come back to God. Learn His ways, why sex is holy, and expect sexual healing from God. And in the name of Jesus Christ, the same Jesus who forgave women who had sold their bodies for sex, the same Jesus who in John chapter 4 made compassionate conversation with a woman who was on her own because none of the other women from the village, those good, morally upright, traditional, family-oriented women, they wouldn't associate with this sexually free, sexually damaged woman. So they just cut her off and let her live on her own in her misery. Jesus Christ reached out to her and honored her. In His name, I invite you, if you are exhausted and despondent, demoralized and empty from the false promises of sexual indulgence, come back to this Jesus. He loves you more than any human ever could, with a love that is better than sex. But precisely because this love is better than sex, and God calls us in the church to enjoy this kind of love, but in a non-sexual way, an intimate way where we share our lives together, but a non-sexual way, I think the apostle in verse 6 was worried that in this matter no one should fall in love with each other and use sexuality to take advantage of each other. That's his point. So the challenge for us, GracePoint and visiting Christians, the challenge for us is, do we know each other in church well enough that we're at risk of an affair? There's a funny way of evaluating church, isn't it? Is my church, are the people at my church in risk of sleeping with each other? You know what I mean. Of course, please don't have an affair. I've had to clean up the mess at another church. GracePoint's going really well. I've had to clean up the mess at another church after bad things happened in sexuality. But you understand my point. The whole of Thessalonians reeks of wonderful, warm, non-sexual, intimate love. And that is the kind of mutual knowledge and support and intimacy that God and the Apostle Paul wants us as God's people to enjoy and to extend to each other. And that is the way that we're not just going to be traditional moral legalists. We're Christians. The way that we control and live our sexuality shows that we know the one true God, where this knowledge is not just obedience, but a deep response to God's love. Do you notice how the whole passage claims divine authority? I've just been saying it, and for those of you who are already Christians, you go, yeah, of course, it's no big deal. But let me show you how almost literally every verse in this passage claims divine authority for this pattern of sexuality. In verse 2, Paul gave instructions not by his own authority, but by the authority of the Lord Jesus. And in verse 3, it is God's will, that you should be sanctified. In verse 5, why do the pagans live in passionate lust? Because they don't know God. They are not familiar with God personally. They don't understand how much He loves them. Verse 6, the end of verse 6, it's not humans who punish for, it's God, the Lord, who will punish if we don't follow His sexual pattern. Verse 7, it's God who calls us to live a holy life. Verse 8, if anyone rejects this instructions, we reject God, who gives the same God who gives us His Holy Spirit. God wants us to obey this pattern. Yes, He does. On His authority, divine authority, but not just because we're legalists. Not just because we believe in traditional family values. Yes, we do, but that's not the foundational reason. It's because we are confident that God loves us. And He loves us in Jesus Christ, who died and rose for us. This is why sex is not just for families. Sex is, we can be sons and daughters of Almighty God. And that means that the way we conduct our sexuality has more to do with honoring our status as God's children, not just about human families. This changes what it means to be sexually fulfilled. Contemporary Western society thinks sex is primarily for fun. That means those of us who are virgins are miserable losers. Traditional society says sex is for family. That means singles are losers, but also it means those of us who are married but who don't have children, perhaps have been trying to have children but can't, it makes childless couples feel really bad. In another church situation, again, not GracePoint, but I've had to clean up the mess when a person from a traditional family background got married, couldn't have children, and their church mocked them. It was really cruel. Not my church, a different church, not even Presbyterian, so you wouldn't know it. And that poor lady was really hurt and perfectly reasonably visited my church because she couldn't go to her own church, because she was mocked as a wicked woman because she couldn't have children. Let me tell you, in the name of God, that is downright wrong. Now, I had no authority over that church, wasn't in my denomination. I couldn't tell them off. I didn't know the minister, nothing. I just sympathized with that woman. And in the name of God, I appeal to you who are Christians and who are family leaders, parents, and older people, grandparents, do not mock and scorn and burden people who can't have children. It's the fastest way to drive them out of church and away from God. The Bible says sex is for God, and real sexuality draws people together. Holy sexuality draws people together when they're married, and it doesn't matter. Yes, sex is for children, but it doesn't matter if you don't have children. Enjoy the way that God brings you together in sexual activity, and praise God for that. With single people also, even if we don't activate, even if we don't enact our sexuality. It means that as we conduct our sexuality according to God's pattern, we can be confident that God approves, and God invites us to find fulfillment in that. Now notice what I'm doing. Our feelings, our emotions, they exist. Our yearnings for sexuality, our yearnings to be complete in another person, that's not wrong. But if we are not married to someone, then the Bible invites and commands us to find our fulfillment not in the desperate, relentless seeking to be fulfilled, but to find our joy and our satisfaction in that sense that we are obeying God, in our conviction that we are sanctifying our sexuality, that we are conducting our sexuality according to God's pattern. That is why holy sexuality is different. It's not about just being a legalist. It's not just about being traditional family values simply for the sake of traditional family values. Holy sexuality is when we conduct our sexuality, we even lay our feelings and our activities before the altar of Almighty God and say to Him, take this and make it holy for you. Be I a single person? Be I a married person without children? Or be I a married person with children, seeking to bring up my children to know and love God and to conduct their sexuality as well in ways that are holy? And all of this, to briefly conclude, is according to the apostolic testimony, the divine teaching which comes through the apostles. Did you notice how the beginning and the end of this passage, the first and the last verse, the Apostle Paul claims the right to communicate God's message? In verse 1, he says, as for other matters, we instructed you how to live in order to please God. What does he know about pleasing God? He's an apostle of God. That's who he is. He has the Holy Spirit of God. He has the personal experience of the risen Lord Jesus, which you can find in 1 Corinthians 9, if you want to look it up. He has the authority. Verse 2, you know what instructions we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. And verse 8, anyone who rejects this instruction which I, the Apostle Paul, am giving you, does not reject a human being, but you reject God, the very God who gives you His Holy Spirit to sanctify our sexuality. This is not unique to sexuality. It's basically the logic of the whole Bible and the New Testament, that God operates through holy, sanctified humans whom the Holy Spirit leads to speak and to write God's message, that we can know how to live for God and to enjoy His good life today. Everybody knows that sex is special. God thinks sex is so special that it is holy. Traditional values say that sex is for families, okay? That's not wrong, but we can experience it in oppressive and burdensome ways. Don't do that. Contemporary Western society says that sex is for freedom and fulfillment. It's never been just for those things. We end up exhausted and empty, not free and fulfilled. God, according to His scriptures, says sex is holy. Sex is for Him. And by His Holy Spirit, He invites and commands us to live our lives as His children, first of all. Children who cry out to God as Father. Children who, by His Holy Spirit, live like Jesus. That gives us a full life, even as a single person, that we are conducting and controlling our sexuality for God, for Jesus. And that makes my life worth living. And whether we have children or not, that God gives us sexuality to bind us together in all that yearning and longing. Enjoy it, the glue that binds you together. And for those of us who do have children, that we would teach our children also to conduct their sexuality, this most important part of our life, in ways that honor God, and therefore we discover how good it is to live for our God. Isn't that a good God? Isn't it good to live by God's Holy Spirit, sanctifying, making holy our sexuality for this good and wholesome God? Let's pray. Thank you, Father God, that you call us to love and care for each other. Thank you for the way that you give us a life worth living, where we love each other and know each other intimately in church and in our small groups, our community groups, as we call them here in GracePoint, in our families, our biological families. We cry out to you that you will help us to love and care for each other. Give us that depth of intimacy so that we know each other well. And precisely in that intimacy, please help us to encourage each other to enjoy, to live, and to sanctify our sexuality. Be we single, married with children, married without children, married with grandchildren, etc., etc. We ask that in all things we will sanctify our sexuality by your Holy Spirit. And in precisely in that holiness, enjoy the fullness of life that is found in you. Amen.
In response to the word that we have heard and the sermon that we have heard Kamal preach to us, our music team is going to lead us in a song of response. So I invite you to all please stand as our music team leads us.
Teach me to walk in righteousness.
friends. The Apostles' Creed is called the Apostles' Creed, not because it was produced by the apostles themselves, but because it contains a brief summary of the teachings of the apostles as contained in the Gospels and the New Testament. So together with Christians since the first century and generations who have affirmed what we believe, we together affirm our faith as expressed in the Apostles' Creed. So let's do that together right now. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you, Joe. We're about to end our formal time of the service, but let's finish on this note. Friends, what are you looking forward to? Well, this week, you know, back to work, back to the office, perhaps you're looking forward to whatever the activity is, but let's finish by considering what God gives to us, a vision of the future. In the very last book of the Bible, Revelation 19, it says, "The wedding of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready." And that image there is us as God's people going to enjoy life with God better than sex. Let that vision bless you as we go out into this world to live and work for the honor and praise of our Almighty God. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon us and our families now and forever. Amen.